Thank you so much, Jemima, Pastor Jemima. I am so thankful, along with our family, we were able to be here. Thank you so much for the invitation. We live in South Bend, Indiana, and greetings from South Bend, Indiana to you. As she has already shared a little bit of history that we share together. We have been together for 30 years now, almost 30 years together, right? In the growing in the Lord, going through life, and you know, have been keeping in touch. And one thing I want to share about the ministry that they do is, even though we live so far away, right? We have been really blessed through the ministries that they are doing. And one, you know, several, I follow all the Partners Ministry newsletters, all the prayer requests that come through. In fact, I pray as though we pray for our own family, right? We pray as a family every day. And so we bring requests to the Lord. And I want to mention about the calendar. Prayer calendar. So I was so, when the first prayer calendar arrived, I think a few years ago, right? And I was like, you know, obviously you have a lot of people sending you calendars wherever you are. And I opened this and I said, what is this? This is different. I have never seen a calendar like that, which specifies from the heart of the Lord. They've been praying what to put in every single day. I mean, 365 days worth of important prayer for our communities, for our families, for the church, for the politicians, for the people that that are in society of influence, who could turn things around, you know, who could make things happen, and and it reminded the Lord asks us to pray for each of those things, and He has placed us as a seed in all those places where we are not. I'm so happy to be with you on a Friendship Sunday that you are celebrating. We have been called the challenge, as Pastor Cyril already read the other verses that that follow this, where Jesus is putting a challenge out to say that you are my friends. In other words, He says, I want you to be my friends, right? So what does it mean? You know, He has already shown us what it is to be a friend. He laid His life down for us. Now the challenge is back to us to say, I want you to be my friends, right? So I am going to follow this theme of, you know, a friend of Jesus, being a friend of Jesus, right? Through the story of my life. So, you know, you might have seen the flyer where it says, come and listen to the transformation that the Lord can make for those who trust in Him. The challenge came to me, when I was 10 years old. So before we get started, right, can we look to the Lord with a word of prayer? Abba, Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord. We thank you that not only you have laid your life down and showed us that you are our friend, but we thank you for the challenge that you threw back at us, Father, asking us to be your friends, asking us to bear the burden that you have for humanity, asking us to be Christ to others, asking us to be the salt and the light of the world just like you were. Asking us to be mini Christ in the world that we live in, Father. Lord, that is the only way we can repay the cost of the cross that you died for us, Father. Lord, by giving our talents, our time, and being there in the place where you want us to be, and being a friend to somebody else, being your friend and connecting them to you, Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day, for giving us this opportunity to come to you, to learn a little bit more, and also to hear the testimony of how we can be a friend, and when we lose it, what can happen, what are the consequences, and how the Lord can bring us back when we resurrender our lives. I pray, Lord, today that you will speak to many of us, Father, who may be going through some stages in life that may be, that may speak to the stages in life that I had been. I pray, Lord, that you become a personal God today. And to each and every one of them, whatever their personal space is, wherever they are in their personal life, Father, I want, Lord, them to feel your touch today, Father. Lord, I want them, Father. We want them as a church together. We want them to feel the touch of God as a friend. And help them to touch you back, Father. To give themselves back to you to say, yes, I want to be your friend. No matter the cost, I want to be your friend, Lord. Father, Lord, help us, Father, to recommit ourselves. And we thank you so much for your presence, your mighty presence, Father, in this place where two or three are gathered in your name. It's not the people that you look, but it's the heart of the people that you look, Lord. Lord, we open our hearts. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So my story will not be complete if I don't give you a little bit just about our background, right? So as Jemima already shared, we are from a very Orthodox Hindu Brahmin family where we worship all kinds of idols. The Lord spoke to my mom first when she was about to commit suicide. So, you know, my mom went through so much in life. Right, lot of troubles and being let down by family and so on, a lot of rejection in her life. So she decided that the best way for her is to end her life. So she was in a depressive state, got married to my dad, but they had no children. And so she was taunted upon. She had, culturally, we are like that, where you get married and you don't have children, you get taunted upon. And so, she was on the path to suicide. And, three or four times the Spirit of the Lord saved her from the clutches of the enemy. And all those efforts failed. The very last effort was when she was in her office. She grabbed my grandfather's sleeping pills in her purse, and she went to the office and she said, I'm going to gobble all of these up and I am done. She went into the toilet, closed the door, and she opened the box, and by the time she was going to put those pills in her, she felt a big hand coming from somewhere and pushing that whole box into the toilet, straight into the drain it went. And she was like, what is going on? I cannot even die. Who is this that is following me and stopping me from doing this? I want to know what's going on. And she started praying to all the gods and goddesses, and she doubled up her prayers and her, her fastings and, laying in front of those idols and asking for an answer. The answer came, but not from a place that she had imagined. So one day she walked into her office and she saw a big change in her own boss's face. And her boss's face was shining. He all of a sudden became a kind man. He was, treating everybody with kindness. And so my mom walked up to him and I said, what is going on with you? I have never seen a word of kindness from you so far. And even the paycheck that you give it with lot of unhappiness that you have to do away with this money, right? Even the paycheck that you give us is not with a happy face, right? So what is going on? We see a lot of change in your face and change in your behavior. And he says, come on, Vimla, come to my office. So my mom was his administrative assistant. So she took dictation, she typed out all his letters and everything. And so she went inside the office and he pulled out a Bible. And he gave that to her and he said, you asked what changed me? This is what changed me. My mom looked at it and she said, Bible? No, this cannot change anyone. And she specifically took the book from his hand and threw it directly in the trash like this. And she walked away. And she walked away and she said, okay, tomorrow he's going to ask me to resign or he's going to give me the pink slip so I might be ready, because she was so clear because when she was a child, she grew up in a Catholic convent. So she went to church. She memorized all those words. But there were some friends of hers who influenced her to think that Christians are here to convert us, to make us not follow the traditions that we are into, and to move us into a different direction. That got into her head so bad that she was not willing to pay attention to any of those classes. So when, but she did all the memorization, all the verses in the Bible she memorized because there were classes that she had to pass, right? So she did all that. When she was ready to get out of the school, all the children knelt down and the mother superior came and prayed for them. And the mother put her hand on my mom and said, God is saying that you are going to be a worship follower of Jesus. And she straight away got up. And Mother Superior gave her a Bible, right? That's how they sent the after 12th standard. That's how they sent the kids away. They prayed for every child. The mother wrote a word in the Bible and gave to every child to take it home. My mom, my grandfather used to say, I have Bibles of all the children in my house except this one, because this one threw it away right in front of the mother superior, right in front of her face, saying, I don't want this. I will become any other. I will convert to any other religion, but not to Christianity. So she threw that and she walked away. And that has been her life. That is the opinion, or that is the ideals that she brings into this family. And so all of a sudden, when this man presents her with the Bible again, she's enraged and she throws it away. But, the Spirit of the Lord starts working now, right? And she was constantly hearing these words in her ears saying, go get the book, go get the book, go get the book, go get the book. And she couldn't sleep. She couldn't, weeks together, she used to come to office with red eyes because there was no sleep in the night. Constantly this struggle going in her heart, go get it. And then finally one day she decides that she will go. And just before that she walks into a church, a large church, the only church that she knew, and she walks up all the way into the front and she looks up at the pew and she says, I don't know if you are the one who is talking in my ears, but if it is you, then I'm going to go get the book. Please stop talking to me. So that's her deal with the Lord, with Christ, when she walked into that. This is the deal. I'm going to go get the book, but you stop talking to me. And so she went and to the office. She put down her bags and she walked into her boss's office. And he was already there. And she's like, "Oh, you're there already." And he says, "Yeah, I'm waiting for you." And she's like, "Waiting for me for what? Is there something urgent?" And he says, "Yeah, sit down. I know you have come to take the book." So she was like, "Oh, what is happening here? This is really spooky, right? How do you know that I have come to take the book?" And then she changed the subject. She said, no, I have not come to take the book." So he says, "No, here it is." So he gives her the book and he gives her another book, which is, a local magazine by a very famous man, Brother Dinakaran. Several people in India know him, and he is the Billy Graham of India. So, he's one of the greatest evangelists that India has known. And so he does a magazine, and that magazine was handed over to her as well. So she brought that and she put the Bible quietly away in her drawer. And then she was more interested in the other book. And she opened, and there were so many testimonies of people just like her. And she's like, could this be true? And there was one particular who had the same things that she had been going through in her life. Like suicidal tendencies, not able to have children, depressive, always full of anger, and completely no joy in life, right? So she's like, here I am, you know, worshiping almost, you know, 3 or 4 dozen gods and goddesses. I have no peace in my heart. I have absolutely no joy in my heart. And this is one woman who says that she found something, and she had been in the same position as I had been. So maybe if I ask, maybe it will happen to me, right? So she kneels down and she starts praying to her gods and goddesses. So she says, gets the name of all these gods and goddesses. It was 6 o'clock in the evening. She waited till everybody left. She sat there and she was looking. She called all her gods and goddesses and said, you know, I am worshiping all of you. I need this peace that this woman is talking about in this thing. All of a sudden, she saw a vision of Christ go by. She knew right away he was standing by the sea. And my mom is so afraid of the seas. Typically she's like that. She's afraid of waters and the sea. And she sees this man standing by the sea with his hands stretched forth, and the seas are calm. And she starts crying. She says, where are my gods and goddesses that I had been serving so faithfully? And where are they? And there was no answer. He says, I am the answer. I am the way. I am the peace. And she didn't know that the, you know, probably because she had memorized some of these verses, it was familiar to her, but she didn't know where it was in the Bible and that Jesus himself was quoting everything that he said in the Bible. About 3 hours, she was there until very, very late in the night. And, you know, she had to get up and go because people would be waiting for her. So she got up and she says that was the first night she was able to sleep like a baby. The peace of God came upon her. The joy of God filled in her heart. And she said, this is it. This is what I have been waiting for all my life. And I had been fighting. I had been throwing stones at it. I had been throwing it away. But here you are, after so many times that I have rejected you, Jesus, but you are still there with your arms stretched forth. And by the very sea that I am afraid of, you were standing. And you were calming it. And so she gave her life to the Lord. But, you know, the story doesn't end there, because she started praying for other souls in her family. My dad was a very, very staunch Hindu himself. And, you know, in his life, he was looking for, in Hindu mythology, we believe that we have to take 7 rebirths before you can go to heaven. Okay, so that is the belief. So my dad challenged the priest to say, if I want to go to heaven when I die now, what should I do? I don't want to go through the 7 birth cycle. What should I do if I want to go? That's a difficult question. You have to get a guru. So the guru will help you what you have to do. So you have to, be very well versed with all the 4 Vedas, Rig, Yajur, Sama, Atharvana, all the 4 big Vedas in Sanskrit. You have to be well versed with all of that. You have to do penances. You have to be regular with this and that. My dad noted down all of those things and he said, okay, now I'm going to go get somebody who will get me into all of those things. So he went and registered himself to a person who had advertised saying that he's a trainer, a guru, right? So he gave his first fees and invited him over to the house. He came over to the house. He did his first session and never returned back. My dad is like, what's going on? Where is this man? He's my guru, right? He later on learned that that man went to somebody else who paid him better. So my dad is, whoa, what kind of guru is this? He is just like me, living for, going about for a living, right? So how is he going to get me to heaven at the end of this? So he says, something's wrong. This is not right. So from then on, he is in search of a guru Who is that guru? Who is that who can take me to heaven right when I die here? I don't want to go through these seven. There should be a reason. If God is God and if he is just, he should have a way. And I want to find the way and I want to live the way. And then somebody else told him, you know, you have to be like Buddha. You have to leave your family. You have to leave everything and you have to go and take a penance in a mountain. And then you will be enlightened. And he followed that. He packed all his bags one day and he was ready. He was ready to go and he went and he wrote a big letter to his mother. And didn't no letter to my mom, no. Only to his mom, he wrote a letter. And then he packed his bag and at the bus stop, he hears the cry of his mother in his ears. He's like, oh, what's going on? What his mother is saying, come back, son, otherwise I'm going to commit suicide. So he got spooked out and he returned. He said, okay, this is probably not the way for me to go because I don't want to lose my mother. Because he follows omens, right? All of these are signs that God is giving him. So he says, okay, that's not the way. So I cannot be a Buddha. What is other ways? He starts reading and reading and reading. He read the whole Quran. He read the whole, on his own, self-reading, whatever he could get, all the philosophies of Vivekananda and Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. And, you know, all of those are great, people who, philosophers in India. So all of that he read. And he's still not getting that thing that this is the guru. So here comes my mom, and the story is so beautiful because all of this happens in a matter of about 4 or 5 years, by which time I was born and my other brother was born, right? And the Lord brought my mom over, and then she was pregnant with my very last brother. And so the Lord is speaking to her saying, invite your husband to go to a prayer meeting. And so my mom says, can we go to a prayer? My dad is like, that's the last thing that I want to do because I have a lot of Christian friends. I don't approve their character. So, they are there to party, do this and do that. But I don't think there is God in that. I don't want to go to a Christian prayer. So my mom has been praying, saying, what should we do? What should we do? And then my dad went and complained to his own mom saying, I cannot believe that my wife is calling me to go to a Christian prayer. My grandmother took him aside and said, son, I know that we don't believe that. We don't want to do anything with that. But guess what? She's pregnant. If we do not satisfy her wishes, you're going to end up with a deformed baby. Okay? So it's very important that you satisfy the wishes of a pregnant woman. Otherwise, you're going to be ending up in a very bad place. So my dad's like, oh, no, I don't want that to happen. So he's like, okay, where is this place? So she invites him to go to a Jesus Calls meeting by this great evangelist. He conducts that in the grounds of the ocean. A million people attend that by attendance. So my dad is one of them sitting in a corner, and 15 minutes into the message, the man says, here is a man sitting who is searching for a guru. You're searching for a guru who will take you to heaven when you die here. If you are here, the Lord is calling you because I have good news for you. I know who the guru is. I have good news for you. You come here right now. My dad did not know anything. He just ran like crazy. It's me. I am the one. Do you have the answer? Where is the guru who can take me to heaven at the end of this birth? And so he prays for my dad, sends him, and the rest of the message is about how Christ came into this world. And I have two verses today, right? John chapter 4, verse 24, that says, God is spirit. They that worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. That's the first verse that I want to point out. The second verse is John chapter 14, verse 6, that says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So these two verses together gives the picture that God is a spirit. He's not an idol. My dad's first question got answered. So God is not in all of these things that I had been doing or pursuing or thinking about. But the word that says truth that connects God to Jesus. So the first verse says, John chapter 4 verse 24 says, they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Right? And then later on, John 14:6 says, who's the truth? Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and the life. So my dad was like, so you're not only showing me the guru, but you're also going to show me the way. Right? So it's not just a person who's going to tell me what to do, but he's also going to show me the way. The way is going to be there. So that was the place that the Lord spoke to my dad, and there was a transformation in his life. They gave their lives to the Lord. They never looked back. So much persecution you can imagine in a family like that, tightly knit. My dad was the only son. He was destined to do all the rites for the family and everything, only son. And he gave up all of that to follow Jesus. So much of persecution my family went through. So this is the background that I want to start with. And in 10 minutes, I will share my story, which is completely different from theirs. But the call of God to be his friend was there. And I want to connect that to you and speak to you. So I was 10 years old. And up until that time, I was not happy with the way that my parents had left their original religion and followed after this. So I was mostly sore with them. You know, I was not happy with the way that they were doing. And so most of my time I spent with my grandparents who were still Hindus. And I loved all the scriptures. I learned all of them. I was very faithfully following all of that. And, when I was about 10 years old, asked my mom something on my birthday. I asked my mom something, and she said, no, God does not like that. So I was so angry with this God that they were always talking about, right? What is this? Always God, always Jesus. And so I was so angry, and I went and shut the door, and I sat in the table that my dad usually uses every day to read his Bible and so on. And I was looking and I was staring directly at a magazine. Okay, and the magazine, I turned the magazine. The magazine had a family picture of ours. Our family picture was there. As a 10-year-old, I was so intrigued. What is this? I am in a magazine? What's going on here? So I started reading the whole thing, and I understood. That was actually a testimony of my parents published in that magazine. And for the first time, without my parents telling me this and that and the other, I was able to look at the testimony of my parents from a different angle. As how they have been searching the peace of God grace of God and the mercy of God, how they have changed it. And I looked at that and I said, I also want this. I too want this peace, because I am not happy. I am not a happy child. I am always haughty. I don't speak. I have never spoken to anyone because I was so proud. Never spoken to anyone. I wanted a change in life. I wanted to be able to be a friend to others, but I could never be because of this blinders that I had, that I belong to a big community, and we never bowed down to anyone. We only had friends with our own community, and we only did things like that. And so I had this blinders on, and I could never reach out to my friends. So I had one girl who attended my school. Her name was Justin. She was the only Christian in the class, okay? And one day she walked up to me and she said, can I sit by you? And I looked at her and I said, no. Are you a Christian? She said, yes. I said, no, you cannot sit by me. This seat belongs to my other friend. I have my friend circle, and this belongs to my other friend. And she says, I have no place to go because my seat is taken over by a girl who is sick, and the teacher had laid her down on the bench, and so I don't have a place to sit. Can you please let me sit because the other girl is not there today? So I reluctantly gave that space to her. God had intended every single step, right? I mean, that simple action triggered something in me. And I turned toward her and I said, have you guys always been Christians? And so she opened her life, and she started sharing things about her life. And she invited me over to the summer camp, the children's summer camp, which is the Vacation Bible School. She invited me over to that. I love to sing. I love to be in front of people. So I liked all of those things because they were encouraging all the kids to go in front and sing and memorize. And I was the number one memorizer. You give me the verse, I could memorize like that. So I wanted to show off, basically, right? So I joined this and I said, hey, here's my opportunity to show off, right? The words of God, the call of God came, and I was able to connect all of that with my parents' testimony. And I said, this is not about going and, preaching and being there in front of whatever. This is a lifestyle that Christ wants us to follow. This is a lifestyle of being, a friend to others. And that girl, even though I rejected her, she was so nice to me. And after that, I never let her sit next to me, even though she invited me over and I did all the others, but I never gave her seat right next to me after that. But God put me in a position where one day I would go to her and say, can I sit next to you? So that's the friendship. And that girl, she was very sickly, and so many miracles happened in her life through her watching how God was doing things in her life. I was so encouraged in my spirit. So that day, on my 10th birthday, I gave my life to the Lord, and I told my mom, what should I do if I need the same peace? So my mom sat with me and led me in the sinner's prayer. And a peace of God came in my heart. And I was so, I was a changed person. If you see me today, I will always be talking to people. I always want to say, how are you doing? How are things going? What can I pray for you? So this is not who I was. God completely changed me from the inside out. A transformation was happening in me. And when I was 17, I was filled with the Spirit of God. And then, I attended a college, Karunia Institute of Technology, which is completely managed by a Christian organization. Lord brought me through all of that. And when I came out of the college, there was so much of promise ahead of me, right? And then that's where I met Jemima. I was 20 years old, and she went to the same postgraduate college as I was, and we had such a great communion together. And the Lord grew us in the spirit and in the ministry, and all kinds of ministry we used to do together in the college and in the community as well, building the community. Fast forward a little bit later, and I was 23, and I was married. And a prayer came to me saying that the Lord is going to bless you, and you will have a son, and you will name him Emmanuel, because God's going to prove that he is with you. God is with you. Emmanuel, God is with you. So I very happily went into the marriage. It was an arranged marriage, but the marriage completely failed. So it was not consummated. I stayed in that for about 7 years. So depressed every day. I couldn't even talk. And I said, God, where are you? I could not, talk to anybody. I could not, sing for the glory of the Lord. I could not, go to a church and meet other people and have fellowship with them. My life went into a very, very dark place, right? Very, very dark place. Those 7 years, the Lord, must have purposed it, right? In a very, very dark place. And I was crying every day and I was extremely depressed. I went through suicidal tendencies and, tried to end my life. There was so much of tension going on in my life, and I was on the verge of giving up Jesus. The only time, I could only pray to him in closed doors, and I always had to act as though everything was going very well. There was nothing wrong in my life. That's the act I had to put on. And so my parents didn't know of this for a long, long time. And when I, presented that to my dad, they were heartbroken in the beginning. But then they said that, the promise of the Lord is always true, Soumya. The promise of the Lord is always true. So we can never question the promises of God. We should go take the promise of God. So how do I take this promise of God? What should I do? And so, finally that marriage ended in a divorce, in a very, very heartbroken divorce it ended. And so, even though that voice reverberated that the promise has to be taken, I had no way physically or emotionally to take the promise. So I completely backslid. I didn't want to do anything with God. It was the year 2000. I came to U.S. Looking for a better life. My dad said, you go there and, you would probably be treated better, right? Maybe a lot of people going through divorces in that country, and so you'll probably be treated. So I came to this country, I went through divorce care, and for about 1 or 2 years I was in a very, very, a dark place. And then I went back to India once, and the Lord spoke to me through that another woman. And she put her hand on me and she said, hear this word. The Lord is saying, there is somebody who's telling you, God has brought you halfway around the world just for me. There's somebody who's telling that to you. And when you hear that, know that God is at work in your life. And so I came back and I was going through, I went to church and I was in a church group, and there was a guy who used to take me, pick me up and take me and bring me back and so on. Lot of Bible verses I used to share with him. And then later on I found out that he was working in the same company as me, right? And used to pick him every Sunday, go to church together and say all these things. And one day, while coming from one of the sessions, he looks at me and he says, gosh, I feel like God has brought you halfway around the world just for me. I feel like God has brought you halfway around the world just for me. All these, wonderful words and Bible verses. I've been a Christian all my life, but, the life that you bring the life of God is calling us to live the life that he's calling us to. And so I called my mom and I said, this happened. And there was a guy, and my mom said, who's that? And I described, and then we didn't talk about that after that. And then my mom said, we can always ask the Lord for confirmation. For whatever it is, we should ask the Lord for confirmation. Let's ask the Lord for confirmation. So we were praying for confirmation. One day this man invites me to his house and he says, I want you to meet somebody. And he says, here is my daughter. He introduces his daughter, and his daughter, in fact, she lives here in San Jose. He introduces his daughter, and I look at her and I said, I know you. But I am not saying that aloud. I am saying it inside. I know her. How do I know her? And so I take leave from them, go into my room, and I start praying. How do I know her? How do I know her? God had shown me her years and years and years ago in my dreams, asking me to pray for her, saying that she is going to go through a very difficult time giving birth to a child. So please pray for her. Whenever that happened, my mom has always told me, you know, don't question God, just do the prayer. He is looking for somebody to stand at the gap and pray. He has chosen you to stand at the gap. Don't ask who it is, where they are, nothing. Just pray. Don't try to figure out who they could be, where they could be. So once I started doing that, the Lord started showing me people, all kinds of people I have seen and I have prayed for who needed prayer at that time. And I never found out what ever happened to them because I don't know who they are. All kinds of races of people I have the Lord had shown. And this was one of that person. She stood very clearly in my eyes, and I saw her. She was pregnant. And I said, oh Lord, you know, this is a confirmation that the Lord was giving. Because the Lord, when his promises come true, it is not always in the packages that you are looking for. You know, he wants to bless you so much. And, you know, I'm talking to people today who are looking for answers in all places, right? When, you know, sometimes when the Lord brings things to you, it is not always in the packages that you are looking for. It will be, you know, if he has called you for a transformation, it will be truly a life of transformation. And so here I was, right in the middle, and then I told, my mom said, pray the prayer of Mary. Pray, Lord, I am in your hands. Use me the way you want, and I give myself into you, right? Because I had said that I will never marry again. I will never, you know, all the promises of God, I don't care where they go, but I am not going into, go into that path again. But here the Lord is putting, and then the Lord gave the blessings of Boaz into our lives. You know, Boaz and Ruth, the blessings of that into our lives. And there is another small medical history that I have to share with you. By the time I got divorced, my womb was shut. You know, historically, medically, my mom and her mom's mom, all their wombs, they went into menopause when they were 28, 29. So the same thing happened to me. My womb was shut and I knew that there was no possibility of children. So when, you know, his proposal came for marriage, I had to share that with him, saying, you know, we're not going to be able to have any children. So, which means I began inside my heart, I was still questioning. But the word of the Lord came very clearly. The same verse, John chapter 15, verse 15, I think, where, you know, if you are my friends, you will do my commandments, right? Yes. So, which means God was calling me to be his friend. So he was going to share all the mysteries with me. You know, he was wanting me to stand in the gap. He had a plan for this family that I was going to be into. He had things that he had planned that in his kingdom. And so I gave myself completely to the Lord. That is what I told the Lord. Yes, Lord, I would be your friend. I want to be your friend. So when I surrendered that, you know, miraculously, after we got married, God opened the womb. I had not one, but two, right? You know, medically, the Lord made that so far. Both of them were, you know, normal delivery, no C-section. And I was up in the age. And so I was, you know, when I look at all the things that has happened in my life and the transformation that the Lord has made, you know, in giving us not only children, but specific purposes, promises for the children that they will. And you know what? I put my trust in the Lord who has called us, who has called me. And when he made true of his promises, right? Made true of his promises, made everything possible, everything that he has promised, he will do for you. The Bible says that he will do for you when we go after that, when we surrender ourselves, when we recommit our lives. So when I came through, when I recommitted my life, I was able to see very clearly, because I was able to now see through my rearview mirror as to what had happened, who I was and who I became and who he has made me to be into the future. So I'm going to end my testimony here, but I want to invite you, any one of you here who feels, I mean, you know, you don't have to come up here or anything, you know, it's obvious, if you want to say that in your heart, that's fine. You know, going through questions in your heart that says, yeah, God has promised all of these things, but none of them are happening in my life. I don't see it happening in my life. You know, if you're able to recommit your life, if you're able to recommit, tell him, yes, Lord, I am there to be your friend. I am your handmaiden. I am your servant. In fact, he actually says, I don't call you servant. If you read that verse very clearly, he says, I am not calling you to be a servant. I'm calling you to be my friend. Right? So that is the call of God in every one of our lives. I mean, if you recommit your life, you know, God will provide transformation in your life, and you will become a seed of transformation for your family, for your society, for the community, for your children, for, next generation and generation to come. And so that you will, God is calling us all to be that tree that will bear its fruits in its season and stand as a fruit-giving tree for the community and the societies that we live in. So can we close with a word of prayer? Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord. Lord, we are so thankful, Father, that you have given us this time to come to your presence. And thank you, Lord, for your voice that we were able to hear clearly of life that is given to you, transformed, and life that could have gone in a different direction had that recommitment not been there. Abba, Father, we thank you for all the blessings that you provide in our lives that are not in the ways that we expected, but we want to commit ourselves and say, here we are, committing ourselves again to you on this Friendship Sunday. We want to say, Lord, that we want to be your friend. We want to stretch our hands and say, we want to be a friend. We want to be that person that you are calling to be, to stand in the gap, praying for others, bringing gospel to others, telling others that the Lord did this for me, he can do it for you too. Or telling others that I understand the temptation that you're going through. I understand the agony that you're going through. I understand the waiting that you're going through. I understand the heartache that you're going through. I understand the physical pain that you're going through. I understand the emotional pain that you're going through, being depressed all the time. I understand that you have right in front of you things that make you think that God's promises are never going to come true. But God is saying today that that is a lie of the enemy. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Father, I bring down all the walls, Father, that is in front of your children from running to you, from stretching their hand forth and enjoying this joyful communion of being your friend, Father. In Jesus' name, Father, Lord, bring down the walls and fill them with your spirit, Father. Lord, you are a friend. You laid down your life, and you are a God who can transform hearts and lives, and we want transformation of heart as people hear us today, Father. We thank you, Lord. Let this community be built, Father. Let these children, Father, be the seeds that will be transforming this community, Father, inside out. We pray for the August 31st Redigging the Wells Revival Conference, Father. We pray, Lord, that people will sign up. We pray that children that will receive your word, Father. We pray, Lord, that the wells will be redug right here, Father. Right here, Father. Lord, we ask for your presence, Father. We ask for the people to stand in the gap, Father. Lord, we ask for the revival, Father, the fire, Lord. Not in one place. If you can make that happen in Azusa, you can make it happen right here, Father. Lord, we ask for that, Father. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for opening up this house of prayer. Bless them. Bless the ministry abundantly, Father. Lord, we ask that there will be overflowing of abundance, Father, of thankfulness, of joyfulness, Lord, in the people who attend, who walk this doors, Father. Lord, we thank you that this church is being a model church by putting prayer first, Father. Lord, many churches we have seen, Lord, that is not the case, Father. So we thank you, Lord, that make this church to be a city on a hill, Father. Lord, as a model church, Father, as putting prayers first, fasting and prayers first, Father. Lord, let communities be opened up. Let, Lord, walls be broken down, Father. Lord, let barriers come down, Father. Let people be, Lord, healed, Lord, in this house, Father. Lord, let the enemy, Lord Jesus, be driven out, Lord, from your presence in this house, Father. Lord, let people receive abundance in this house, Father. Lord, let people receive miraculous healing in this house, Father. We thank you, Lord. We thank you and praise you, Father. We give you all the honor and glory. We bless this ministry in this place and this beautiful family and every single family member who are attending today and who are watching us, Father. Lord, we bless everyone. Give you all the honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.